Sviatlana Tsikhanouskaya, welcome to Scandinavia.
Thank you.
It's quite a situation that we could see here, and the fact that you are now leading the opposition from exile. But take me back a couple of years. Take me back 2 years. What was your life like then?
Oh, last 10 years, I was a housewife. I was upbringing my children. I stayed at home. I couldn't work because one of my children, a child with special needs, I had to upbring him to rehabilitate him. So I have husband who was taking care about us, just financially, and I could be involved in my family. So ordinary woman. I was a teacher of English, and nothing and special.
But then, your husband. Who's a part of the opposition, gets arrested.
Yep.
And you're stepping up. You described it as an act of love. In what way?
This was him who wanted to run for presidency because he really wanted to do something for our country. He communicated to people. He asked them how is their life. What are the businesses? And he had heard so many sad stories, and we saw, our economical situation of our country. No development, like people have low salaries, and he really wanted to change something. He, while having his YouTube channel, he understood that he's fighting against a monster, because in previous elections, we also had political prisoners, we also had, like, brutality in Belarus, so we knew what he was fighting against. But it was his intention, and I followed him. You know, I, as the most of Belarusians, was a politician for a long, long time, because for 27 years of dictatorship, we, like, people in Belarus knew that, what can I do in such situation? You know, he has violence, brutality, and, but last year, something magnificent happened with people. We, like, woke up, and my husband was one of the reasons, like, COVID was one of the reasons. So many, many things brought us to the situation when, people started to think about our country, about our nation. They took responsibility. And when my husband claimed that I want to be the president, he was detained next day. And I brought his documents to Central Election Commission, and they refused. Mm. And I came home, and, I wanted to show, first of all, to my husband that what he was doing is important for me, that I love him, I needed to support him somehow. It wasn't my intention, to run for presidency. It was only for him, my first step. My documents were registered, and then...
Why do you think you were allowed to run if he wasn't?
I'm sure that regime wanted to make love of me, make love at me, because they were sure, look, who in our country would vote for a woman, for housewife, without any political background? Look, everybody will be laughing at you, and the regime will be winners.
So the prospect of a female leader like we have here, it's
and
impossible.
The fact that I was female also played its role. But regime lost connection with people. They didn't catch the mood of people, that people, the generation have changed, that we have opportunity to see the world, how other countries live, and we are awakening step by step.
Was that the last time you saw your husband was when he was detained?
No, he was released after my documents have been adopted. But he stayed in freedom for maybe 1 week. Because when regime saw how many people are coming to put the signature for candidate for me, but people understood that it was for him. He was the person who, you know, who oppressed people, and the regime was frightened, and he jailed my husband again. And they were sure that without my husband, look again, everything will be silenced.
Did they come to your house, or how
did that happen? No, he was on the rally where people put in their signatures for candidates. Just it was provocation, and he was like brutally put into military van, and I haven't seen him since. It was on the 29th of May last year.
How do you stay in touch? Can you talk to him, or?
You know, I live in other country in Lithuania at the moment. I'm not in Belarus, but we are communicating through the lawyer, only short messages. But even those relatives who live in the country, they don't have opportunity to communicate with the political prisoners. There is no such procedures. You are sending just short messages through lawyer who may visit prisoners.
But tell me about that moment when you realized that staying in Belarus was too dangerous for you and your children.
Every day after I brought my documents to Central Election Commission, I felt scared. I felt that it's so dangerous because we realized what a big brutal machine has been built for 27 years. We knew this, but I saw people around.
That's how long he's been in power.
Yeah. And I remember my every morning starting, I can be detained today. I had always this special bag with extra socks, you know, just in case I'm detained, I will at least be have warm clothes. And but okay, you are scared. Millions of people are scared. But we have to move forward. We don't have other choice. That people woke up, we saw each other, we understood that we are not alone, because before politics was discussed like in the kitchens, whispering, because it was too dangerous to be vocal.
Was it a hard decision for you to
leave the country?
To leave the country?
It was the next day after presidential election, and I came to Central Election Commission to bring the document that we are against fraudulent election. And there I was met by two officials who described me my future if I stay in Belarus, that my husband is already in jail, you will be in jail for millions of years, and you will not see how your children will grow up. So it's like psychological pressure. And, you know, they like advised me to leave the country. And at that moment, my children already were in Lithuania. And I just, at that moment, understanding that my responsibility in front of Belarusians, my like inner mother won at that moment. And I left the country to join my children. It was a very difficult decision.
Just to get a picture of how the situation is, how many people has been, democratically minded people has been jailed because of this since you left, approximately?
More than 40,000 people have been detained since last year. At the moment, in the country, 888 political prisoners, recognized political prisoners, and thousands, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, it's difficult to count, prisoners for political motivated cases.
Would it be fair to say that being just having like a normal conversation like we have now, sit like this, speaking openly, is that impossible in Belarus now, or?
Look, freedom of speech is, of course, an extremely painful question for Belarus, because since last year, all the alternative media have been destroyed in our country. And just in case we are sitting here and start to discuss political questions, in a couple of minutes, you know, riot policemen will come and we will be jailed, for sure.
Do you, sorry.
No.
Do you like feel safe now here in Sweden?
In Sweden, among you, I feel safe, but its safeness is a little bit more than just sitting here. We have to understand that one of journalists who was flying from one European Union country to another in the flight, and Lukashenko kidnapped this flight. He made this flight land in Minsk, and this journalist was kidnapped. So we don't know how long the regime's hands are. Mm. So I understand that I'm the target because I'm too vocal. You know, I represent Belarusian society on the international arena, and you know, I don't know what could happen to me.
But do you, what could we do in Sweden to help you? I mean, I actually know a woman that is very powerful in Sweden, right? So maybe I can talk to her. No, but seriously, is there any... How could we help you?
You know, Sweden may be a separate story because Sweden has been supporting Belarusian society for more than 25 years already. Was very active all the time, supporting students, medics, teachers, whoever else. And we understand that Swedish people, you know, their hearts are bleeding, you know, about the situation in Belarus. And I just want to use this opportunity and say thank you for your speech where you said that Belarus will be
A priority.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for your governing. And it's very important because a lot of countries, of course, we see the huge support and solidarity from all the European Union countries, from the USA, UK. But words are words. But to make commitment to your words, it's real. It needs real prayerness.
So what has been, when you're traveling around talking to world leaders, as you are, what has been the disappointment?
You know, I'm really grateful for what European countries, democratic countries, are doing for Belarus. More than 1 year, we on the agenda in all the countries, and it's, you know, it's really important. Maybe when I started my way in politics, I was sure that, look, you are in European Union, at least 27 powerful countries. Mm-hmm. You can do so much, you know, to help Belarusians. But I faced a problem that there is so much bureaucracy. Decisions, especially that need a consensus, are made so slow. When people in Belarus have been tortured, humiliated, violated, you know, European Union countries were discussing what to do. Should we impose sanctions, or maybe we should give chance, you know, to Belarusians to solve the crisis themselves? When there were thousands of political prisoners, okay, first package of sanctions was imposed, rather moral one, but at least, you know, very, very slow decisions. And the first, and, you know, all the time we have been asking for economic pressure on the regime because with dictatorship, only powerful leverage are important, like economic isolation, political isolation. And the first powerful sanctions have been imposed only after 10 months after our uprising.
Do you think that the fact that Putin's influence on Belarus is what it is? Do you think that that is a part of the slow reaction?
I don't think that Putin is part of this reaction because I'm sure that European countries, you know, you know, don't look at other countries, you know, and make the decisions themselves. I still believe in this. And of course, there was like understanding in European countries that Belarus like appendix of Russia. There was such perception, but we are not. We are a separate country with our own language, with our own culture. Our sovereignty and independence is like a priority for Belarusians. Maybe it influenced, but this slowness maybe was in hesitating, like, okay, should we wait? What's going on there? It happened before. How long this resistance will continue?
You know, is there something more like we can do as a people, not like the politicians, but as a people? Is there some way we can help? Because everybody here is like in shock when you're telling this.
Again, I'm using this opportunity to explain people that everyone can take part in our revolution, in our painful revolution. Because just imagine thousands of people in jails. They think they are abandoned. They know that people are fighting instead of them, that European society is also supporting. But they need your attention. Every person who is here now, who is watching this program, I ask you tonight, write a letter to political prisoner. It will take 10 minutes of your time, but it will be such a huge support for those who are behind the bars, losing their health, you know, that sacrifice their freedom, you know, to give us opportunity to continue. Put your income into this revolution.
Can you understand the frustration of trying to get the West to act and that it goes so slow?
Absolutely, I can understand it. And 27 countries in the European Union, decision-making is sometimes slow. I think you're pointing to something that is so important, that to fight for democracy in your own country, but also helping others to fight for democracy. Each and one of us cannot do everything, but every one of us can participate and do something. So we should really do something and help from our different perspectives to help Belarus.
But of course, you can do even more.
I can do, yes. and really, this is something that we have been working with from the Swedish government quite intensively. But
You first.
No, you first.
Yeah, okay. I just want to ask you, why is this such a priority? You have several dictators in the world, but in this situation, it's seems very relevant. For Scandinavia.
Well, it's also, I mean, it's really close to us. Mm. I mean, and you live in Lithuania, it's one of the Baltic states, and I mean, the Nordic-Baltic cooperation is very close. And then, of course, Belarus is something that also feels very, very close to us. And, but I was really wanted to ask you something. I mean, to me, you're such an impressive person. This was not how you planned your life. This was not what you were striving for, but the situation came up and you stepped forward and did what was necessary to do. It's such an inner strength. I mean, where does this inner strength come from?
You know, there are, of course, moments when I'm so exhausted, when I'm tired and overstressed. But look, every evening coming home, I see my children asking where my daddy, where I'm going to see my daddy, when will he come back? And I understand that there are thousands of broken families. Thousands of people are suffering in jails, are humiliated there. And you understand how many people had to lose everything, lose businesses, lose their apartments, and had to relocate. They are trying to survive somehow now. And you understand, you have no choice. You have to move forward because people believed in you. And I understand that I have huge support. So every morning when you don't want to leave your warm bed, you understand your husband now can't take his shower, can't drink a cup of coffee. He's in solitary cell, he has no communication, so stand up and go forward. You have to do this for him, for thousands of people, for millions of Belarusians. You will have your rest later, somewhere, together with your husband, but not now.
Svetlana, you have been describing yourself, and I quote you here, as a weak woman, but not anymore.
Okay, I think that every woman is strong. Sometimes maybe it's easier to pretend you are weak, or maybe when life doesn't put you in circumstances where you have to be strong, you think you're weak. But
was it like that for you?
Yeah. I always was. My husband was always taking care of me. I thought, oh, I'm weak. What could I do, you know, without him? But I see that for him, for millions of Belarusians, I can do so much. And you know, it's rather difficult to keep Belarus on agenda. It's very difficult to keep people believe in our victory, but they see me. I'm moving forward. I keep strong, and like they see, if Svetlana can, why cannot I? So yes, I'm strong.
Can I ask something? Do you think it would be possible to negotiate with Lukashenko? Because you talk about revolution, and that's I mean it's like very violent, of course, and it's like a big takeover. But would it be possible to slowly push it in a good way? And in
would you like to sit down with him?
As for revolution, when you say a word revolution, you pretend it's something bloody, you know, violence. It was violence from the side of riot policemen, from the side of the regime. We want our revolution to stay peaceful. Mm-hmm. We are peaceful Belarusians. We don't want any victims. And I really believe that in the 21st century, we can sit and talk without any sufferings of people. Mm-hmm. And our strategy is we understand that the way out of this crisis is only new, free and fair election instead of fraudulent one. Mm-hmm. But for this election, we will come through negotiations, through dialogue. And yes, I'm ready to sit with representatives of the regime and discuss transition period, to discuss new elections, because we are people, we have our chance to communicate. Mm-hmm. Not in our in peaceful times, we have to solve the crisis peacefully. Mm-hmm.
What is your impression from outside? Is it that Lukashenko is getting stronger or weaker?
I think it's difficult to say. I mean, what we're trying to do from the European Union is with the sanctions to weaken his power and his regime. And of course, also we want to support the freedom fighters and those that are fighting for democracy in Belarus. Mm-hmm. And also we are discussing right now further sanctions. So
have you met him, Lukashenko?
No.
But is he getting weaker or is he getting stronger?
Of course he's getting weaker. Maybe it's not visible because he's look like a strong person, but he's not. He's nervous at the moment. He's so fragile. He understands that there is no more support from the side of Belarusian people. It irritates him. He lost the image of a strong person in eyes of Belarusian people. This is very important for him. He's isolated economically and politically from European Union countries. Sanctions that are imposed also weakening businesses around him. Sanctions are not for ruining our economy. Sanctions are for splitting elites. The businesses that are around him, they question themselves, are we ready to lose our millions, you know, for the sake of one person? You know, of course not. And, you know, there are, like, Lukashenko is very afraid of betrayal from his own team. That's why he's rearranging all the time ministers and all this stuff. And look, we don't have other way out because we try to appeal to him diplomatically through different organizations. No answer. So the only leverage that democratic countries have, powerful countries, are to have this targeted sanction policy towards Lukashenko. Isolation, non-recognition, it's important to him that countries start communicate to him, talking to him. That's why this crisis on the border was created. he wanted to say, look, I created this crisis, you can communicate to me and I will solve this crisis. And thanks to European Union countries for their principled position that we will not recognize you. We will try to solve this crisis differently, like with the countries of origin of those people, with humanitarian aid, but not with you. And it works.
Svetlana, if you look back on your old life, what do you miss the most?
I miss...
Apart from your husband, of course.
Look, these are tiny things that you haven't noticed even when you lived with your family. You know, I miss my apartment where I created all the things myself. You know, I miss my relatives. I miss, you know, time with my children because I don't have much of communication with them now. I miss a sense of... calmness, you know, in myself. You are always like overstressed. You have to do something. Why are you sitting and drinking your coffee? You know, the mother of five children in prison now, you know, she's missing. You have to do all the time, you know, something important, something that will make our victory closer.
Do you think that time will come back?
Of course. I'm absolutely sure that Belarus will be a success story of peaceful transition of power from a dictatorship to democratic changes. And
but for you, do you think that time will come back for you? Just drinking your coffee and doing...
Oh, you know, I don't know. I really miss the times when I was in my small family, happy. But of course, maybe having such deep experience in politics, having installed these bridges between our people and democratic countries, maybe I could be useful in future Belarus. If people need me, I will be with my people. Maybe there will be also difficult times and I will not have time for a cup of coffee, but I will be happy.
You think you can be the next president?
Say yes.
Yes. Look, I didn't have intention to be the next president of Belarus. And during my pre-election campaign, I promised people that I'm here with you until new elections, where you will be able to choose a person you want who in prison, you know. But again, I could be useful for Belarus. It's not necessary to be president of your country to do something special for blossoming of Belarus. So I'm not going to be the candidate, but who knows?
Who knows? But things have changed for you, probably.
Things have changed, of course. You know, I wasn't prepared for such you know, brutal change in my life. I had to study a lot during this more than 1 year. It's the world of politics was like a mess for me. The structure of European Parliament, Council of Europe, European Council. You know, it's all these structures were so not understandable to me. But I had to study very fast, and I have to admit that I have the best teachers ever. Like, I'm studying from prime ministers, from presidents, you know, from ministers of foreign affairs, and so on.
And I'm sure she can have your cell phone, right?
Absolutely. And if you become the president, I would definitely love to come to visit you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.